All right. Well, good evening, everyone. Welcome to Law Week, Zoom style for the fall semester. I'm glad that you all could make it, and I'm so glad to have our awesome panelists with us who were once in your shoes as legal studies majors. So really excited to have them with us tonight. And if you have questions, which I hope you do, I hope we don't have like a silent room. You're going to have the opportunity either to say it audibly, which I hope you take advantage of that, or put it in the chat. I'll monitor the chat. But basically, you know, this is kind of like popcorn. Just have your time that we have, which is an hour with our panelists tonight. So without further ado, I'll give them the opportunity to introduce themselves, starting with Mr. Taylor.
All right. Hi, everyone, and thanks for coming and attending tonight. My name is Pierce Taylor, and I went to UCF and obviously was in legal studies. I also had a criminal justice minor, and I graduated in 2012. You could say that UCF is kind of a family affair for me. I've had a bunch of cousins, couple uncles, my mom, my sister, all attend and go to UCF, as well as my wife, who I met there. After I graduated from UCF, I went to Florida Coastal School of Law up in Jacksonville and participated in on the moot court team, where I competed in multiple national competitions, and then made the decision to take the Georgia bar, where I am barred, and I work in a firm, Swift Curry McGee and Ayers, in Atlanta. My practice primarily involves workers' comp defense, where I represent the employers and the insurers in workers' compensation claims around the state.
All right, thank you. And Mr. Alba?
Hello, everybody. This is my least favorite part, introducing myself. I also went to UCF for the legal studies major and a minor in communications. UCF was some of the best years of my life. Definitely would not trade that for anything. After UCF, I went to Vanderbilt School of Law. Picked it because stayed black and gold, didn't have to change any of my wardrobe. So then from there, I went back home to Orlando and I took the Florida bar. And I have been a member of the Holland & Knight construction litigation team since then. But I've actually just gotten barred in Colorado because my wife's work took us out here to Denver. So I am now actually barred in Colorado and Florida. I do Florida construction law from my basement here in Denver. So it is it's a wild profession. It's a lot of fun.
All right, and Mr. Zamora.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me. I went to UCF. I graduated in 2006 with a legal studies degree. I had a minor in criminal justice. I then went to University of Florida College of Law immediately after UCF, and I got a job from there in 2010, starting with the prosecutor's office, the state attorney's office in Miami. So I got to work there for about 4 years before I opened up my own firm. I opened up a firm in Miami where I do criminal defense. We do some family law, some complex civil litigation, not much, only for a niche clientele, but the bulk of what I do is criminal work. I came back up to Orlando in 2015. I mainly practice out of Orlando now. I do have an office still in Miami. Most recently, I've been working with a candidate who some of you might know, Monique Worrell, for state attorney. She's the candidate who just won the Democratic nominee. So I've been working with her on that campaign in criminal justice reform. So I'd say the focus of my career has been in the criminal sector, both on prosecution and defense. And go Knights, go Gators.
All right, and Ms. Thompson.
Hi guys, my name is Krista Thompson. I am also a 2006 UCF Legal Studies grad. I then went to UCF again for a master's degree before I went to Seton Hall Law, where I graduated in 2011. So I've been practicing for about a decade in a pretty non-traditional path. I've been in-house for my whole career. I'm a business transactional lawyer by practice primarily. I've worked largely in supply chains of a various organization, negotiating, drafting, executing deals. In supply chain, I spent about 5 years of my career at FedEx, worked for the Broadway theaters in New York for a few years, and now I work for a joint venture between Airbus and OneWeb called Airbus OneWeb Satellites. We mass manufacture satellites to launch into low Earth orbit in outer space.
Thank you. And Mr. Gurney?
Naturally, I would follow someone who's in space law, which is way cooler than what I do. My name is Nicholas Gurney. I am obviously a legal studies graduate from UCF. Happy to talk about that. Love my time here. I went on to the University of Florida Levin College of Law. And when I was finishing at UF in the latter years, I did what's called a CLI, ACLI, where you're able to practice while you're in school before you take and pass the bar. And I did that in criminal defense, public defender's offices in two cities. Now I work at a firm in Orlando doing complex catastrophic injury, wrongful death litigation and trial work with a focus primarily on defective products. So I'm not a hard science, I don't have a hard science background, but I love the hard science aspect of what we do. We're able to take a product and try to figure out what went wrong and what could have been done to prevent it. And I'm also this semester back at UCF teaching a class on rhetoric as an adjunct professor in the legal studies department. So I'm a little biased, but I'm thrilled to be back and happy to take questions.
Thank you, Mr. Ackerman.
I'm sure this is the one everyone's been waiting for. Before I introduce myself, I kind of just want to encourage you guys to turn your cameras on. Johnny, Augustus, Riem, Yasmin, like, good on you. Johnny, if you could smile a little bit, you're in the dead center of my screen and you just look like you're staring at me blankly. I'd appreciate it. Thank you, sir. So I am not a trial lawyer. In fact, I hate trial work with the fiery passion of a thousand suns. Krista and I are both transactional attorneys, which means that we work with contracts and business. I specifically work in legal and compliance for the financial services industry, which means I work with very large banks. Way to go, Cameron. Even got the mask on during a virtual event. Bravo. I work for major banks, and basically what compliance does and what I do is I make sure that these large multinational banks don't do dumb things with your money and make sure that they comply with all the various laws in the various jurisdictions that they're working in.
Thank you.
And I'm an old fashioned.
Ms. Hall.
Hi, my name is Tanisha Hall. I graduated from UCF back in 1998. I was one of the founding members of the trial team. I was very active in File for Delta when I was there. And I started my internships in family law at UCF and have been doing family law ever since. I graduated from University of Florida Law in 2001 and have been working at the Legal Aid Society of the Orange County Bar Association since then. I've done all things family law. I've also handled other things that we handle in our office, such as housing, consumer, immigration, dependency, probate, unemployment comp at one time. I have not done any bankruptcies, but we handle those, as well as a whole host of other free civil legal issues for low income or victims of crime and domestic violence. I am on a lot of different committees. I sit on the board of the Florida Bar Family Law Section Executive Council. I'm the current chair of the Orange County Bar Association's Family Law Committee. I am the litigation director here at the Legal Aid Society. And so I help bring you all in as interns. And right now we have the law school graduate program, the supervised practice program for those of you who are unable to take the bar. prior to February. For those, I've already started receiving resumes to assist in that. So I'm here to help. I can go to lunch with you. I can Zoom you, chat you, Microsoft Teams, whatever. If you ever have any questions about the practice of law or, you know, legal aid or, you know, the public sector, even though we're really a private nonprofit. So I'm happy to be here.
Thank you. And Ms. Moda. You want to unmute.
Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Hello, my name is Mia Moda. I work as Associate General Counsel of a company called AssistRx. We are a technology, the healthcare technology company that serves large pharmaceutical companies. Someone just walked in the conference room, I apologize. And I graduated from UCF in 2012. And yeah, I love working in health. So shout out to all my in-house people.
All right, thank you, panelists. So I would like to relinquish the floor, the Zoom floor, that is, to you all. Whoever wants to go first, if not, I'll go first with the question that I think would be fitting, but I want to give you like a brief moment to come up with something, even though I know you probably already have something in your head. You can either say it audibly, which like Mr. Ackerman mentioned, don't be afraid, don't be shy, or you can put it in the chat.
Is it okay if I go first?
Absolutely.
Okay, my first question is, what was the process like landing your first position after law school, and what role did your law school play, if any?
Well, I'll start. It's very important, if you haven't already, that you apply to become a CLI, because that was one way to get in the door, to get experience, because you can handle a lot more cases and have a lot more duties and responsibilities under the supervision of an attorney, provided you are a certified legal intern. So in my last year of law school, I did a clinic, and I also had an externship as well as a fellowship. And that's because coming from UCF, as you know, if you're in legal studies, all the classes you're taking are pretty much going to be all the classes you need for your first year of law school. So my first year of law school was such a breeze that nobody believed that I was a 1L when I came in, and I was able to do more things in the community. So I externed for a judge to see how things were. I worked at the full representation clinic. And then, you know, I found a fellowship through the Florida Bar Foundation. And that allowed me to not only go out into the placements to see if those were the type of firms that I wanted to work at, but while I was there, if you're under any supervisor, pretty much, if you're coming out as a law school graduate or a law school intern, they're going to put you in place with the local young lawyers section. And I'm all about networking. You have your network now of all your classmates, but when you're out doing your internships, externships, or working as a young lawyer, that's how you're gonna start building your referral source. That's how you're gonna build your professionalism, your enhancement, and have a place to decompress at times. So once I got into the community, I made connections in that community and was able to follow up on those upon graduation.
I'm going to go from a completely different end, if you don't mind, because I had, like I said, a non-traditional path. I didn't participate in the write-on for the journal competitions. I didn't go and try to clerk my first year. I actually went and really believed that if I wanted to work in-house my entire career, my goal, by the way, was to never work a day of my life in a law firm. So far, I've been successful. It's not for everyone. It was just my chosen path, but I just went and I took a job with at the end of first year with a sports agency, just basically working as a legal intern. I, you know, catapulted from there to, you know, another position, and like just kind of going and taking any legal work in a business setting so that I could have transactional experience, and, you know, by the time I graduated law school would be in a position to basically have already had a few years of work behind me. So I didn't participate in OCI and OCR and all of the things that happen traditionally in law school. And while I'm not saying I encourage that route, because it's a harder path, it really is. You have to be really motivated to not go that traditional route. It is possible. You don't have to do it exactly how they tell you. You don't have to follow, you know, this very strict guideline. If you don't want to work in a law firm, there's a path to that. If you don't want to work even as a traditional lawyer, if you want to have a non-traditional legal role, there's a path to that as well. So I would just encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity, network with us following this if you have specific questions about our paths. But like, there's not just one way to succeed. There's definitely a main path that most people take, but it's not the only way. And I'm probably, I don't know if I'm the only one on the panel or not, but I certainly took that path knowing I was going to be the odd one out. But that's just because I didn't want to practice traditionally in a law firm.
But, so I want to echo something that Krista said, because that is insanely important. You are going to hear you're going to hear one path, okay? And only one. You need to kill your grades the first semester, get into the top 10% of the class. Then you go into your second semester, but you're already going through your OCI, which is essentially trying to get your first job as a 1L student, okay? And then if you don't get into the top 10% of your class, then you're not going to get into one of the big law firms. You're not going to be a summer associate. Then they'll ask you back for the second summer. And then the third summer is when they offer you a job. And then you work for 3 years as a summer associate in a big job, hate your life, don't see anybody, work for 100 billion hours a month. And then after a couple of years, you either go in-house or you move up to partnership track, in which case you probably have some form of personality disorder. So that is not the only way, okay? That is the way that they are going to explain it to you, that because that's the only way that they know. What Krista had just mentioned is, do not freak out if you don't kill your grades the first semester. Because you know what? 90% of the people don't, okay? 90% of the people do not get into the top 10% of the class. So when you talk about path and you talk about trying to find your first job or whatnot, I would, one thing that I think is pretty consistent among all of us today, except for Andrew, who is barred in two states, which is borderline sadistic, is—
it's a bad choice.
I can't believe you took more than one bar exam. You, sir, are— I wish I could hand this to you virtually. At the end of the day, do what you're passionate about. Figure out something that you absolutely love. I did the route. I went and I killed my grades and I got my dream job at an international M&A firm. And my first, like I would say my third day there, I called my now wife up, who I met at UCF, and I said, "This sucks. After the summer is over, I am never doing this again." And guess what? I didn't. So apparently somebody is really importantly trying to get in touch with me. But ultimately, just if you take nothing else from this panel today, I want you to know when you go in there, you're gonna have a manufactured stress. It is going to be awful. It's going to be amazing. It's going to challenge you. You're going to step up to that challenge, and you're going to do things that you didn't know you were capable of doing. And at the end of the day, whether you are number one in the class or you are number 297th, there is going to be a path for you to become a lawyer. There is going to be a path for you to become successful, whatever that success looks like. And there is going to be a path for you to excel at what you do. Try not to be 297th.
Can I briefly cap this one off? Because I feel like I did the stereotype route. I went to school. I got decent grades. My first summer, I actually studied abroad. And then I clerked for the second half of the summer with a judge in on the 5th DCA. And then my second summer, I did a whole bunch of OCI. I'm talking a lot of OCI. You would go into one interview, You run through the whole thing, go out, 5 minute break, go into the next one. I just churned through them. Then I got a summer associateship at Holland & Knight, did a 8 week summer with them, got a job offer, came back after that, and I've been there for 4 years now. So, and to go back to the original question of how involved my school was, it was pretty involved. Holland & Knight was not an OCI option. So they were just kind of my own, like, send resumes to everybody who has a JD in Orlando. But as far as getting to that point, my law school, and I'm sure it's representative of many law schools, they gave substantial assistance to creating a resume that's effective, to helping you target markets that, like, geographic locations that you want to be in, putting you in contact with alumni that know other lawyers in the area that will kind of give you an idea of who's hiring, what they're hiring for. Because I didn't have a laser focus on what I wanted to do as a lawyer. I was just kind of in this bucket of people that go to law school and want to be a lawyer, like, generic. So for me, it was more about finding a job that would lead me to what I like than it was knowing what I wanted to do. So I took that very traditional, boring track. And I found it very helpful, as long as I just kind of leaned on the school to give me guidance of what my options were.
So I want to jump in.
Right. Go ahead.
Real quick, I think two things that are really important is that OCI is a great opportunity because you get to do interviews. And anytime that you can interview is a great opportunity to hone your interviewing skills. So I applied to some OCI jobs that I didn't even really care about, only because I wanted to get good at the interview. So I think that one thing you can do at school when you're there is to, and also it's an opportunity for you to interview the company or the firm or the, you know, the office that you're looking for. And so there's sometimes I walked out of interviews and I just didn't really vibe well with the people that I met there, and I didn't really like what they were saying about the firm, and I knew, and that was great for me. But another thing that I think we're not mentioning, and I came out in 2010, I think Krista, you said 2010 as well, and that's the economy. Like, when we came out, there was no jobs. We had went to law school, everyone was on freezes. If you were getting offers from Holland & Knight, they were like furloughing it a year out, and you had to decide, you know, do I want to wait a year and commit to this job, and what am I going to do? So, like, a very real thing that's going to be happening your 3L year is, like, what's going on in the world? Where do we stand? Where can I, you know, did I have to take out student loans? And is it better for me to invest 10 years in the public sector where maybe my loans will be forgiven, or did I not? If you want to do trial work, like, if you decide that you want to do trial work and you're not like Dave, then you probably want to start at the public defender's office like Nicholas did, or at the prosecutor's office like I did, because that's a great opportunity, like a residency for a doctor, to really learn trial work, because you're not going to learn it anywhere else, because trial work is a dying work because of mandatory mediations and a variety of boring things you're going to learn throughout your legal career. So just to touch on everything they touched on, I think using OCI is a real big tool that the school will give you.
Thank you all so much. It was two questions waiting in the chat. One of which is there, thinking back, is there anything you wish you would have done before entering your first year of law school? And then there's another one after, right after that.
Just nap a lot.
My thoughts on that is, being in the legal studies program, I think somebody else said it earlier, that really kind of gives you a solid basis for your first year classes when you get to law school, because you basically have the background already. I mean, of course, you're going to go into a significant more detail about the things you originally learn, and there's going to be an implementation of the Socratic method, which is sadistic in and of itself. But there's a lot of stress outside of it, but it was very comforting that I already knew what they were talking about. Whenever they would bring up a new subject, people were struggling with something, and I was thinking to myself, I learned this as a sophomore at UCF. But otherwise, I think I would have rather maybe taken the LSAT a little bit more seriously, tried to get a higher grade on that and go to a state school instead of a private school, largely for money issues and how much in loans I would have to have taken out. But as far as preparation, I mean, I think legal studies definitely does it.
I want to just add on to what you just said, Pierce, about loans, because it's going to be, I mean, and most likely that's something that's going to be a very big part of your consideration. One thing that I wish that I had done differently, it's not necessarily done before law school, but I wish I really like worked hard to understand whether or not it was important to go to the best law school that I could, the most expensive law school that I could, the place that I ultimately wanted to practice and work in, and I probably would have examined that a little differently. I ended up choosing a very high-cost law school that was in an area that I wanted to practice, but that really wasn't a necessary part of the equation. I think one of the other panelists said, you know, I went to school here, and I moved back home and took the bar here. I took the bar in two states, New York and New Jersey. I'm admitted in five states. Because also crazy, and I love paying bar dues, apparently. But like, you don't really have to practice or go to law school in the area that you want to practice. So if I would truly go and be the best law student at the cheapest good law school that I could go to if I were to do it again, because it's really something to think about, you know, coming out of law school with, it could be as low as $60,000, $70,000 or as high as, you know, $250,000 of loans. That's a really big thing to walk into the rest of your life with, and a lot of pressure when you're entering the workforce to really pursue a certain path. So one thing I'd really, really think about is crushing the LSAT to get, as much scholarship money as that you can get, and choosing a law school that is affordable, that you can do well at, but I don't think it was nearly as important to go to the top tier law school, particularly if you don't want to pursue the big law route.
I want to jump in real quick. I would say get your passport, travel, work for at least 6 months at a law firm in the field that you think you want to work at, and then 6 months later, look back and figure out if you were right. And then spend a lot of time with yourself. I took a year off, so I did this, but spend a lot of time with yourself and figure out who you are as a person and who you want to be, because sometimes you wake up and it's 5 years later and I see the next question coming, and I'll turn it over to that because you'll get some interesting answers.
Sure will. I appreciate everyone's response. The next question is about balance, work-life balance. So part of this, I feel like I can even answer, but they're asking, is going through all the schooling and then enjoying the job, managing time with work and daily life. If Ms. Thompson or Mr. Gurney want to try that one out.
Yeah, if we're talking about work-life balance, I'm going to defer to my colleagues.
I'll talk about work-life balance. So I'm a single mom. I have three young kids, a 1, 2, and a 4-year-old. Been living in a pandemic and have managed to be able to work and have home life with the help of a nanny, you know, during that time. I have loved every job that I've had. I mentioned I worked for Broadway, I worked for FedEx for 5 years, and now I'm working for, you know, a company that shoots stuff into outer space, which is so cool. Like, you find a way to love your job. It's not, it's really the area of law. I love deals, I love transactions, I love, you know, business. And so it's not really the setting that's applied in for me. It's really the kind of work that I'm doing, the people that I'm working with. And work-life balance in-house is different at every single company. So I can't speak to law firm life. I don't want to speak to law firm life. But it's really about, there are days and weeks where I, you know, put my kids to bed and I work until 4 a.m. I manage a bicontinental team. Half of my team is in Toulouse, France. So I'm often, you know, trying to work in a 6-hour ahead schedule. That's just part of what it is. But I also can run to doctor's appointments in the middle of the day and pick up my kids when they're sick from school and, you know, not really have to take personal time for those kinds of things. So there's give and take, I think, really in every company is going to be different. Every law firm is going to be different. It's just really, you know, kind of how you make it. You have to find time to stay you. There are a lot of lawyers that are really burned out, are, you know, have drug or alcohol addiction, that struggle with mental health issues. And there's a huge stigma in our profession about getting help with that. That's something that you'll hear over and over again in law school. So it's so important, like Nick said, figure out who you are so that when you go through this rigorous, invigorating and exciting experience in law school, when you come out on the other end, you're just a better version of you. You're a more well-rounded version of you. That would be how I would approach it.
I can speak from a firm standpoint because I do work in a decently large firm in Atlanta. We are generally expected to work to keep core hours in the office. So basically 9 to 5, but obviously we work beyond that. We have a billable hour requirement of just over 2,000 for the year, which puts us at like about a 180 a month of hours that we have to bill. But even with that, I mean, I generally work 9 to 6 or so, work weekends every now and then. But I think an important aspect of a work-life balance is actually enjoying where you work. I worked at a firm previously that I really didn't like. I didn't get along with the partner that I worked for, and it was rather miserable before I moved here. And the firm that I'm at now is absolutely wonderful. There's great people that I can, well, during the COVID situation, I don't see very many people, but I can speak to people. They have a great mentorship program here that they just help us out wherever we need. So I'm much happier here and frankly glad to work even longer hours if I need to. But generally I'm home by 6:30 most nights, unless there's a hearing that I have to prep for or something that it just absolutely has to get done that day.
Yeah, I'll also speak from the firm perspective. I went the big law route, so I've got that perspective of those massive firm. We have about 1,900 billable hour requirement. But I also have the benefit of perspective. I have a number of friends that ended up in markets like DC, New York, that had a very different experience in big law than I did in Orlando. So for the most part, I would say my experience is similar to Pierce's. It's some weeks are easy. They're like a standard work week. I start work at around 8. I end work at around 5. Maybe answer a few emails here and there. Not every weekend I have to work, but then there are weeks where there's like a trial or something like that. And those are significantly more difficult. But if you're going to go somewhere like New York, you need to be aware that those hours are astronomically different. Every single peer of mine that graduated that went to New York, they put in closer to 320 billable hours a month for a period of years. So that's a lot of burnout happens right there. So just be aware of that.
All right, so there's two questions in the chat. First one is, student is unsure of which field of law they want to go into, and they want to know, how did you decide that was the field of law you wanted to pursue, and are you content in the field you chose? I'm going to ask Mr. Zamora and Ms. Moda to answer that.
So I knew I wanted to do trial work. And I knew that the best place to do trial work was at the state attorney's office or the public defender's office. So for me, I knew that if I couldn't get some big job making tons of money out of school, that was the best place for me to learn and start my career. Now, what threw me for a loop is I never expected to be a prosecutor. I always thought I'd be a defense attorney. I grew up a minority in a heavily policed area. And so the issues of criminal justice and how the system worked was really important to me. And I thought I was going to go help everybody from the defense side of it. But then after doing on-campus interviews, I got the job as a prosecutor, and I sit here with you now, and I've been a prosecutor for 4 years. I've been a defense attorney for 6 years. I've tried cases on both sides, and the best job I've ever had was in the prosecutor's office, because it's an opportunity every day to do the right thing. Like, I'm really involved in major decisions that affect everyone's life. And for me, not speaking to anyone else, I love it. And I love being in court, and I love doing trial work, and I love being a part of complex trial issues. So I was lucky in the sense that I knew what I wanted to do, and I found the best path there for myself.
Yeah, so for me, I've always loved technology law and healthcare law. And so I got really lucky to do both those things. Technology, healthcare, and business, all three in one. And I was blessed to have the opportunity to actually start a legal department from scratch, which has been awesome. It's been super challenging, but so much fun at the same time. And especially working at a company that's, you know, growing at a it's crazy, but it's really important to figure out what area of law you want to practice, before you get out there and start practicing, because what I've seen is typically your first job, you're kind of be locked in on whatever particular area of law that you're working in, and it's very difficult to kind of steer away. So it's important to brand yourself and get every opportunity to get experience in that particular area of the law. So when I was in law school, what we currently had was only, like, for externships, was only like family law and criminal law. And I knew from the start that I did not want to do that, and I wanted to be a deals lawyer. So I actually started my own externship at my law school to help technology companies. So I guess the initiative is really on you to go out there and figure out what you love, because if you're, like, I hate to be cliche, but like if you're practicing the area of law that you love, like it's not work, it's just it's so much fun. So I would just encourage everyone to really think about it and really just design your really have all your courses tailored to that, so you can be the best possible attorney in that particular area of law, and you'll be set up from the get-go. Hopefully that answered the question.
Thank you. So another.
Crystal, if I can.
Yeah.
Just want to also let you know that it's also not about finding the type of law that you like. You can also factor in finding out what you don't like to do. So you may think, like, I thought I wanted to do international law because I love to travel. I sat into an international law class and was bored out of my mind, and flip to either criminal or family. So you're not gonna specialize in any particular area when you go to law school, unless you're getting an LLM or something like that. So you don't have to know what type of law you wanna practice before law school. You really don't have to know what type of law you wanna practice when you graduate. I mean, the beauty of having a JD is there are 1,001 things that you can do with that degree. So the same way you're focused on knowing what you like, focus on learning what you don't like. Like, I didn't want to do billable hours. It's funny now that we actually have billable hours at Legal Aid, but I didn't want to do billable hours. I didn't want to be in a firm. Yeah, bill 1800, because we have grants, we have funders, we have, politicians, and everybody else wants to know what we're doing with the money that we receive.
Andrew, you lost your drink. It's now going to Tunisia.
Gladly.
Right?
He deserves it. Legal Aid deserves it.
And so I bill probably $225 a month. And that's because I like what I do. My clients work nights and weekends. I'm texting them nights and weekends. I have Google Voice so that I can screen them out. And it's just what I do. I like it. It's not work for me. And then, I shut down a couple hours to hang out with my kids. And then they go to bed, and sometimes I boot back up. So one, when it's what you like as law, also realize the things that you don't like, you definitely want to do. I wanted to do litigation. I didn't want to be transactional. I was okay with jury trials. Some people don't like jury trials because that's a whole nother factor of litigation. And then for the work-life balance, your work is never going to be done, no matter what. And I say this as a supervisor, and I say this as a workaholic. Your work is never going to be done, because just as soon as you think you're caught up with something, something else is going to happen. And if you were to leave the firm today, somebody else will pick up your work tomorrow and carry on. So keep that in mind when you're, you know, stressing and killing yourself over your work-life balance. I just saw something recently on Facebook. Your family is the one that's going to actually miss you if something happens. Your employers will replace your position. So just keep that in the back of your mind as well.
Awesome. There was another question in the chat that says, I wanted to know how the panel dealt with paying for law school, if they had any programs they would advise us to go through or scholarships to be aware of. I want to just put that one out there. Anyone can take it, but there was another thing mentioned later on, and we're getting close, so I don't want to spend too much time, but just whoever wants to answer it.
I think this was, we touched on this one earlier. I know Krista mentioned it when she was discussing making a decision about potentially an economical but good law school. I took out student loans, and honestly, when I started and I agreed to take those student loans, I didn't fully realize kind of the ramifications were, and that they would end up adding up very, very quickly, and the interest is not low, so it keeps adding up. So it's, I would recommend doing some, if loans is how you plan on paying for law school, I recommend really doing some research into them, and then kind of figuring out if there are ways of reducing how many loans you take out overall. Maybe living in a smaller apartment, getting roommates, things like that, that could help cut your overhead costs down. And I know some law schools, mine in particular, offer a kind of an abbreviated program where you take extra classes each semester, and they have some financial incentives to do that. But you end up finishing law school in two or just over 2 years instead of 3 years. So you save yourself a couple of semesters of loans, but also of living expenses that you would face also taking out those loans to cover.
All right, so I want to jump in real quick. Take a basic finance class if you haven't already. Personal finance at UCF is phenomenal. I took that class. It's incredible. You learn about the time value of money, which is a concept. It's very easy to understand once you learn it. I know lawyers that don't understand that, and frankly, that's insane to me. I bought a house recently, and Dave's probably to thank for this fact. When you buy a house, they have to give you a piece of paper that shows 360 months of payments, what's called PITI, and whenever certain things fall off, but it shows how much you're paying, and you're actually paying 2 to 3 times the cost of the house over 30 years because of interest. Interest is insane. It's the craziest concept we've ever come up with. The reason why banks have to show you that when you buy a house is thanks to Dave, because they were ripping people off. They don't do that with student loans. And the student loan interest rate is twice what it is to buy a house right now. So financially, fiscally, it's probably a better decision to buy a house. I say that as a lawyer, know what you're getting yourself into. And I agree with Krista's analysis earlier. Think of, do I want to be a big fish in a big pond, a big fish in a small pond, or some combination? And there are a lot of really, really good law schools out there that are great value law schools. And I'll plug mine. Florida, University of Florida's in-state rate is insane good compared to some law schools. So definitely do your research, live frugally, do the cup of soup thing. I slept on friends' floors, family members' floors when I was doing externships, clerkships. I was traveling all around, and I was doing it on a dime. And when you do that now and you learn the personal finance side of it, you're doing it for your future so you can be comfortable in the future.
And Nick, the crazy thing is it's double how much you're probably paying right now for your house. And it's the only type of debt that can't be discharged in bankruptcy. So if you wonder why I drink, there you go.
So I want to add something. I know that the loans are horrible for law school, but it also depends on where you are in life. Like I'm the first person to ever go to college in my family. Like for me to go to law school was a monumental task. My family did everything they could to help me with UCF. And if it weren't for the loans that were available to me, I mean, Nicholas is absolutely right. You do need to be cognizant of what you're doing. And I was, but I'm here to tell you that if you fall in that category of persons that, hey, am I going to take out a loan to go to law school? I really want to do this, but I'm scared to take a loan. Take the loan. Don't take loans you don't need because you don't want to get a part-time job, or because, you know what, it's cool to have an extra $10,000 while I'm studying for the bar. That's the stuff that is just ridiculous and will come to bite you in the butt in the long end. But if you need it, and this is going to help you get where you need to get in life for whatever reason, don't be scared of the loans, because you are going to do well. You are going to jump out and get a good job. You're going to have the ceiling, the literally space is the limit, right, Krista? You can make as much money or as little money as you want in this industry. And that JD is going to do that for you. So don't be scared, be smart. That's the only piggyback I had to that.
There was one thing mentioned in the chat by Ms. Thompson that I wanted to bring to light about the LSAT, but I also wanted to bring to light about the bar exam. You know, and I know that might sound a little far-fetched or a little far ahead, but really all of y'all that are on here have to think about, okay, there's the LSAT, that's the big kahuna, at least right now, but then there's the bar exam, which you need in order to be able to practice. So
let me jump this, and then I'm sure like some of the other panelists have some to offer in here. And I'll add, there's actually even one farther than the bar exam, which is really admission to the state bar, which I actually have a friend that I graduated with law school with, that it's not 9 years after graduation, and it's still not admitted to the state. He passed the bar. He then took the bar again, because your bar passage is only good for 5 years if you don't get admitted, and he's still not admitted. So there's something that you really need to think about during this time, and it's called character and fitness. You'll hear that a lot in law school. The decisions you make now will affect your ability to get admitted. Imagine taking out $200,000 of student loans, studying for the bar, passing the bar, the exhilarating feeling you're going to have, and then not getting admitted to practice because you got a DUI in law school, or you forgot to disclose something that, you know, was significant. All of your decisions right now will affect your ability to practice law, and that will stay true for every year that you're a lawyer. We are a self-regulating profession, so, you know, the decisions that each of us make could bring us subject to disciplinary proceedings, and it's very important to remember that. I will tell you that I think I found, when I was studying for the LSAT, what I considered to be, like, I had great grades, you know, generally an A, sometimes AB student. I did well on standardized tests, but never like excellent. But when I was studying for the LSAT, I really feel like I figured it out. And what you have to do, in my opinion, is you study the test. There are only so many kinds of questions that they can offer on the bar exam and on the LSAT. In the LSAT, you generally have about the four different categories, at least I think it was four different categories of, you know, questions. And then each of those have several different iterations. If logic games is something that seems difficult for you, you'll learn there's 8 kinds of logic games. You just have to learn how to do each kind of game. And then it's just really a plug and chug. Sub in the numbers, sub in the statistics, the facts that they give you. And that's what you do. You study the questions, how to answer each question, and then you can apply it. I did that and scored very, very well on the LSAT and the bar exam. And I was I graduated like in the 50 percentile of my law school class. Like I didn't have the best law school grades. And it was not a prohibiting factor to my practicing in the profession whatsoever. But really what you need to do is not just think now, but think to the future and think how to study these tests so that you can beat the test. That's all it is. It's not some people are better at it than others. It's not there a little bit of luck. All of those things play a factor, but you really need to learn the test. You know, I did a Princeton review program for the LSAT and Barbary for law school. And there is a methodology that will help you succeed even if you are only an average exam taker. And I would encourage you to study the test.
I tell this to my students because they ask a lot about this. They want to ask about the bar exam as they're going into the process of applying to law school. And I think a good analogy, and it should help put people at ease, is everything you do is like the hardest thing you've ever done. So when I took the LSAT, I was like, this is the hardest thing I've ever done. Nothing will be more difficult. And then you take your first law school exam and it's terrifying and it's the hardest thing you've ever done. And then you take your 6-hour long con law exam and it's the hardest thing you've ever done. And then you take the bar exam, it's the hardest thing you've ever done. I think law school and the process of becoming a lawyer is kind of a lesson in resilience. And the more you're able to kind of work on yourself in developing skills of resilience, stick-to-itiveness, there's a really good book called Stickability, which is about people developing resilience in difficult situations, and it gives practical advice. That's a really important skill to develop along the way, and you will naturally, but you want to focus on it because before long, you're worrying about your first trial or your first appeal or taking the board certification exam, which is another exam you can take later, or taking 5 bars. So there's always more. And before long, you just look back and go, I don't know, I probably have some brain damage from law school. So it's, you know, same. It's a wash.
Yeah. On the subject of the bar exam, I will agree with Nick and Krista. One, it is a monster. I mean, there's a reason it's almost universally dreaded by lawyers about to take it, that have taken it. But it's also it's a game. I mean, like Krista said, you can learn it. You can figure out its tricks. And then by the time you take it, if you study the test, you'll be fine. I mean, there's nothing they can throw at you that's going to be a surprise, because they have to tell you what's going to be all the potential subjects. Where they get you is all of the vast amount of subjects that could be on it. And so once you know where you're weak and what you already know very well, you can study, you'll be fine. It's not the end of the world. It will feel like it the day of, but it'll be fine. Say, okay, it's easy.
I legit panicked before it. I would be the first person to admit that. Like, I think, I don't remember what exactly it was. I saw some video online about a guy who taught himself how to walk again after a bad accident. And I ended up crying for like 7 minutes for no reason whatsoever. So it is a completely manufactured stress. It's going to mess with your head. I'd say probably about a day and a half before I took the exam, I looked at my wife and I'm like, I'm not ready. I didn't get through enough of the percentage to take it. And she looked at me and she said, I'm not going through this again. You're going to take it and you're going to pass. Thankfully, that's what happened. I am not like Andrew and Krista, and I'm not a huge fan of putting myself through that multiple times. But at the end of the day, just try to grow comfortable with being uncomfortable. You're going to feel that way in law school. You're going to feel that way at your first job. Everyone has what I like to call the oh shit moment. When you sit down in that chair and you get your first file and you open it up and you look down, that is your reaction, because now it's on you. Now you are ready to rock and roll. So whether it's the bar exam, whether it's a final exam, whether it's practice, you're going to have that moment. We all have it. It doesn't make it any better, but at least you know that you're not the only person that's ever experienced that.
Dave,
and the first file is always a disaster.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like I need to dispel the notion that I took 2 bars. I actually begged the Colorado Supreme Court to just let me waive in, and they, mercy on mercies, granted it. So I avoided taking a second bar.
I have never wanted to hurt a human being so much in my life right now.
It is
having
the weirdest story.
I agree with that, yeah.
I actually got a call from the Office of Attorney Admissions saying, hey, we looked at your file, looks good, sorry that you're going to take the bar in February. By the way, the only thing you're missing is reciprocity, since Florida sucks. So why don't you just ask the court to waive it? And I was like, that's an option? So I did, and they granted it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
You're a good lawyer.
One thing One thing I wanted to mention about kind of the prepping for the bar exam is to get with a good reputable test prep program. I used Barbary and it was terrific. But what I did is I just treated it like a job, probably 6 days a week, 7 days sometimes, but I would do kind of a 9 to 5 and get as much done as I could in that process so that that I was very consistent with it and got, I think I got like over 90% done with the program before the bar exam. But I had friends who would just go from 7 a.m. till midnight every single day of the week, never took a break, really burned themselves out and ended up not, not passing the bar. So I think it's important to still take a little time for yourself in there, but trust the program. If you get with something like Barbary, they teach you those methods of how to attack the question and how to differentiate what they're asking and figure out immediately. A lot of times you can eliminate one or two answers off the bat just by knowing what they're asking. So these programs really teach you how to do that.
Well, this was great. We are now at 6 o'clock. So in respect of everyone's time, especially my panelists, we're going to end it. This is going to be available after we make some tweaks. So this will be available for students to go back to. And I know the panelists are leaving their email address in the chat, which is much appreciated. So reach out if you have additional questions that we didn't get to. I know there was at least one I didn't get to. So thank you all for joining us tonight.